So we want to welcome our guest this week, Gavin Mcinnes. If you happen to not know who he is, you're probably over 85 or can't read past a fourth grade level. Gavin's a co-founder of Vice, is an actor and an author, and frequent contributor to Fox. He's been in the news recently after receiving backlash for his article entitled "Transphobia is Perfectly Natural," where he asserts, among other things, that it's normal to be transphobic and that their post-op genitalia resembles a cheese pastry. His book, The Death of Cool, is a hilariously entertaining read, and his new movie, How to Be a Man, can be found on Netflix right now, and it's definitely one of the funnier movies I've seen all year. Gavin, thanks a lot for being here, man.
Thanks for having me.
I've read your article about transphobia, and although I wouldn't consider myself transphobic, I related the idea behind the piece, and you know, there's an abnormality with anyone who desires to have their genitalia cut off. So would you say that the backlash you received from the article was because you said it was natural to be transphobic, or that you alluded to them being mentally unstable?
I think the problem is the way I write is like stand-up comedy, and I'm not kidding, but you know, you have this sort of hyperbolic way of getting a point across, like when I said short hair is rape. On stage, I would explain the feelings I get when I fucked a girl with short hair from behind. I'd get mad. Because I'd look down, I'd see a little boy, and I'd go, "You tricked me," you know? It makes me feel violated. That's a true thing that happened to me. But when you type it out, especially to young people, they go, you want women with short hair to go to jail for sexually violating you? I mean, they're so literal, the kids today. And that's why I think David Tell says comedy is dead. And again, I'm not saying I'm kidding about any of this, but I think the way I talk is so mean.
Yeah, I think it'd be when you approach a serious topic in a joking manner, people seem to think that you're minimizing the seriousness of it.
Sure, but I was talking more to these college students who say die cis scum, and I mean not real ladies who've had a sex change and are quietly living in Switzerland. Although there's a great documentary called The Regretters about two women who did the sex change and how much they regret it and how they look when they look down, they remove the bandages, how horrible they felt. And I mean, if I was writing at Tacky Mag, it would have been a much more serious take, and I'd talk about, yes, there's obviously a percentage who do it and they're happier, but I'm talking more about, you know, other groups who do it and regret it, which is the vast majority according to a lot of doctors. And the suicide rate is brutal, you know.
Yeah.
So rather than – I should have phrased it nicer, obviously. I mean, if one thing I've learned about transsexuals, it's that you don't go near that subject ever to anyone ever again. I mean, you're not fighting them per se. I mean, some of the most rational response I got were from Bailey J and Justine Tunney. And they, mm-hmm. you know, they wanted to discuss it and stuff. That's what rational people do. But when you poke the hive of college kids who are pretending to be something – it would be like when I was in college and you made fun of Wiggers and told them they're not black and they'd have a heart attack, you know, and call you racist and blah, blah, blah. That was the modern equivalent. I mean, it's basically – here's the deal with the whole thing. There's four groups. There's the college kids pretending, and that's just like a weird people going through their sexual experimental phase and deciding that they're not a gender and putting on mascara or whatever. They're phonies. There's the actual people who need the sex change and are better off for it, a very tiny minority. And there's yeah. the ones who get it because the culture has encouraged it and they regret it. And then there's the kids who are told, you know, encouraged to believe that they're another gender or they're just, you know, gay or something. And they don't know that that's an option. And I've heard there's this Canadian doctor who's in a lot of trouble for saying, "Why don't you try being a fag for a little while and get back to me before we do something this drastic like hormone blockers?" So a lot of people say, "Why did you poke that hive?" And I said, I guess because I'm not scared of the shrill internet mob, and that's group one, the college kids. But also because of the suicide rate and the kids taking hormone blockers, I go, okay, this what's a fad to you damages people's lives. And it's sort of like when I was punk, heroin was cool. And then I went, whoa, whoa, people are dying, you know, slow down. So, of course, I'm not denying that it's possible that you're one of the exceptions and it was good for you. But I, you know, I was just pointing out that what's a fad to some can be dangerous to others. And I didn't phrase it very well and got in a bunch of trouble.
Yeah, Two things, actually. In terms of what you said earlier about your writing, to me, you're a new phenomenon to me. Joe had told me we were going to interview you, and so I did. It was one article, and I was in love. Like, that's the style of writing everybody should be using.
In a game,
you know, very direct. Well, it's very funny, you know, and it gets a good point. I wouldn't have read a bland article about transphobia. I just wouldn't be bothered. Like, it was just.
So you're saying you're gay for me?
Yeah, fucking right I am. You are my new gay crush. There's no question about that. I get a sex change for you.
How far do you want to go with that? Like, obviously you hang out, but.
I like Canadians, too. I'm a Canadian, so you get that.
So what if we were laughing and we were tickling each other, and I was just like, and then you felt a small kiss near your ear?
You're my star crush, so I would go with it. I'd giggle. I'd blush.
It'd be like a celebrity pass or whatever.
It'd be like, yeah. Like, I don't know if you watched Kenny versus Spenny when it was on.
I was on that show.
Well, when Spenny went in for the gay kiss.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
That awkward moment.
We used to play at parties and stuff, and then we just started making out because everyone screamed, and it's not like you die after. I had some guy, he wanted to blackmail me because he said he had a picture of a black cock in my mouth. And I'm like,
did he?
No. he was talking about a picture that Ryan McGinley took of someone doing coke off of this black dude, ear snot's cock. Ear snot's gay. And so was the guy doing the coke. Not that that matters. But, that picture through word of mouth or whatever became me passed out with a dick in my mouth. And so he thought, I'm going to get the picture, but I'm going to blackmail him first, get some money. Maybe I won't even have to get the picture, which if you're going to blackmail someone, step one is to have the thing. That's a crucial detail.
Is this your way of, trying to explain away an awful picture I'm going to come across later? Is this? That's not me.
Well, that's step two. I go, if that was the picture, A, I'm asleep. But B, if I had a gay boyfriend for 3 years, you know, and then I realized I'm straight and married my wife, that's no scandal. I don't fucking care. So I'm not like a politician who's made his platform on gays don't exist and then bang, you got me the photo. I would just go, okay, whatever. So even if the most outlandish case of that, which was me smoking my boyfriend's hog, don't care, dude. So that's strike three with your fucking black man. Anyway, we're off at a tangent, but.
I've never met a gay named Ear Snot. That's a one-off for me.
He's a pretty popular graffiti artist here in New York.
The other thing I wanted to bring up to you, my kid brought home a school contact form, and on it, it asked born gender. Male, female, chosen gender, male, female, independent. She's six.
Wow, that's amazing. See, that's the, I mean, I'm reluctant to talk about it because it's such a fucking powder keg. But, and these people, this shrill minority of posers have incredible power on the internet to fuck up your life. Because when all these companies get these tweets or get angry phone calls, they assume it's someone who's sane, you know? It's sort of in old people's mind, it's the same as a protest with signs out front. But anyway, I personally think that that's just a fad. It's a fashion thing that's gone really, really far.
You were supposed to be on the Opie and Anthony show a while ago, and from what I read, I guess Jim Norton canceled you because of an apparent conflict between his Vice show and your previous tenor there. Did you see that as him buckling under the pressure of wanting his show to succeed or just making the wrong call?
Yeah, that's why I told him to fuck off. I mean, we had a long argument about it for almost an hour, and we agreed to keep the phone call to ourselves. I mean, his point was that it's an important show to him, and he didn't want to – I don't know. I don't want to divulge the content of our call, but his thing was like Vice is his show, and I was a Vice enemy, and he didn't know anything about me, so – maybe he thought it would be better to, you know, be more prepared. He wasn't banning me. I think he was just postponing it. And my point don't be a pussy about that kind of stuff. Be unprepared. Why do you have to be prepared all the time? What are you, William F. Buckley? I like Jim Norton. I mean, I followed him up until that beef.
Well, we're big Jim Norton fans here. But we
various.
You know, yeah, very. One of the few stand-up comedians I actually really like.
And he stood by Anthony with all that stuff, and he's been on Anthony's show, which probably pisses off Sirius. He's a great guy.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
It was cool to call me. He doesn't even know me. I've never met him. And we, you know, we had that. We argued it out for an hour and a half. So it's pretty rare, you know, on Twitter when you say fuck you, it's pretty rare you get an hour and a half phone call explaining the situation. So I can't wait for that.
When two guys like you get on the phone in a heated conversation, I assume it was a little bit heated.
It was
like that's got to be.
It was an hour and a half of yelling.
Yeah, that's got to be a gold mine of funny quotes because, you know, I would be terrified to get into an argument with either one of you.
Well, it was pretty. It was very civil. There was a lot of like, no, okay, no, that's a good point. That's a good point. I'll take that back.
Which you have to do. You have to accept a valid point from you know, an opposing.
Well, that's how adults talk, you know. They don't go out on Twitter and try to fuck up your life. They say, let's have a debate. And that's the real sad thing about intellectual discourse in this day and age. It's gone from – I read a great essay about it recently. Called It's gone from freedom of speech to freedom from speech. And now you deserve to be free from things that make you uncomfortable. And that, by definition, is not learning. Learning is being uncomfortable, being confronted with data that contradicts your belief, being told you're wrong, being offended. Being offended is a huge part of becoming intelligent. Being perpetually unoffended is being in a bubble.
I read an opinion piece about your article specifically the other day saying that there's people shouldn't be opposing it. And the author of the piece said, you know, he thought you were a fucking lunatic, but that your piece deserved to be heard so that you could debate those things.
Yeah. And that's the funny thing, too. Like when I sat down with that transvestite or whatever she is, Bailey J, she says herself, she goes, I'm not a man, but maybe I'm not a woman, transgendered person. You know, that died on the vine. No one wanted to hear that. It was a civil discussion between two people who disagreed. That wasn't incendiary. It wasn't exciting. They want a bad guy. They want Hitler. They want a villain so they can rail against him because that justifies this really simplistic liberal arts education. But when you get to be my age, you realize it's not as simple as good guys and bad guys. And everyone you dislike, like Jim Norton, I told him to fuck off. And then an hour and a half later, I sort of saw both of our points pretty clearly.
Yeah, you actually mentioned that on the Anthony Cumia show, how you don't have any one set viewpoint. It changes from time to time. You know, nobody can rightfully classify you or categorize you as being, you know, completely left-wing or right-wing because you have things you agree with from all walks of life and things you disagree with. So,
I mean, outside of religion, which I think is a very personal and spiritual thing, you shouldn't believe anything. I mean, I've been back and forth so many times on Israel, I get a headache every time I think about it. And I've been totally passionate on both sides.
I mean, yeah. Where do you stand now? I have to know.
Well, I think ISIS turned us all into neocons. I mean, every isolationist, libertarian, even the guys I know who are anti-Semitic are putting all that on hold. I'll hate Jews next year. We got to take care of this right now.
But what do you think about the American involvement with ISIS or lack thereof? I mean, you've lived in America for a long time now, and you've done the journalism thing, so you know you kind of see it from a different perspective when they're getting beheaded over there. Do you think the U.S. should do more, back up and take care of Russia?
You can't have someone decapitate your citizens and be proud of it. And London is the same way. I mean, they stab a man with a meat cleaver, and he says, you got what you had it coming. And then we have our own citizens, our own young people saying, see why they hate us? I mean, I hate us too. I mean, what happened was we ruled out patriotism because it was for jocks and the captain of the football team became uncool. And it was – I blame the show Square Pegs, by the way. The 80s show, Sarah Jessica Parker, where nerds became cool. I was victim of it, too. I mean, I was a big part of it. Hipsters are just eccentric nerds that have been put on a pedestal. But anyway, what we did when we flushed out all the culture and tradition is we created a vacuum. And that enabled all of this intolerance to flood in. And I'm not talking about cool culture, although that has become very fascist in a lot of ways. Like the political correctness, they are bigger bullies than the captain of the football team ever were.
Absolutely.
I thought a lot of this sort of liberal arts stuff is about revenge, you know, like with all the names for pronouns and genders. That's really just, well, I felt uncomfortable when I was young, so I want you to feel uncomfortable around me now. I don't want you to not know what to call me. you just got to figure it out and sort of awkwardly avoid the subject. Now who's awkward, bitch? but on a more serious scale with ISIS and extremist terrorism, you say, fuck your country, fuck America, we're a globalist thing. And then young men, they go, well, I'm fucking mad at the world. Anyone else mad? Yes, we are mad. Come over here, fucking let's kill in the name of peace and love. So they go, yeah, that sounds fun. So we created a vacuum, and it got filled with way more intolerance than we were avoiding in the first place. Greg Gutfeld talks about a lot of this in Not Cool. He goes, you know, cool culture and anti-traditionalism has pushed itself out into a corner with nothing to replace it. So what's going to replace it? The nearest bully is going to walk in. And it's trivializing it to call these guys bullies. We've gone way beyond bully.
And you raised a good point in the article you wrote. We didn't train Nazis here during, you know, the early stages of World War II. But it just seems we're more sympathetic to extremist clerics and things of that nature in Western society.
Look at Britain with this fucking child prostitution ring that involved dozens and dozens of victims. I mean, it's – and the police were scared of – the short story is the police were scared of racism, but the way they phrased it is they were scared of stirring community unrest, which is – that's just a quintessential example of the problems with this obsession with making everyone happy. The people who want to make you unhappy just handle it. I remember being a punk rocker in the 80s, and we'd go to these anarchist gatherings, and all of the problems that we're having today, I learned about when I was 17 and 18 at these things. Like, we had a talking stick. There'd be that one punk dude who was punk because he had a shitty life, and he'd be holding the talking stick talking about how his therapist says that he's an alcoholic and, you know, no one understands him. And we're sort of going, dude, we want to talk about the patriarchy and smash the state and Emma Goldman and stuff, and you're boring me with stories of your personal life. But we couldn't get on with it because we had given him this stupid talking stick. There was a guy named Carl who wore a dress, and he was transgendered, I guess. And he went to this thing with all these single moms about children and youth and raising children. And he was the only man there. They let him in because he had a dress on and they didn't want to argue. And a lot of these young single moms, a lot of these punk women would have kids young. They'd always be named Asia, I noticed, by the way. And so he comes up with his – he was British, and he comes up with this thing. He goes, you know, what a lot of people don't understand is that children are sexual beings. I mean, they have sexual desires. And as young as 8 or 9, we feel that, you know, we have to block that away when we should be helping them, you know, explore that. And they were all going, whoa, what the fuck did you just say? So he gets chased out of there with flaming torches behind him like Frankenstein. And we kind of learned what pushing the boundaries can do, you know, when you have total disregard for something that's worked for 40,000 years. And again, the beauty of libertarianism is you're not telling anyone what to do. I mean, when I – the most outlandish, horrible things I say, I don't institute into law because they're none of my beeswax. I'm not the boss of the world.
When I was about 8 or 9, the furthest sexual exploration I did was me and the other kid across the street would like hide behind the shed and show each other our dicks because we were curious.
Yeah, there's but a lot I don't, of shit going on when I was – when all boys are little boys. It's not so much – I remember beating off before I could come and it would just go red.
Yeah, you didn't know what was supposed to happen after that.
Yeah.
Your movie, How to Be a Man, is on Netflix right now. Is that your first foray into acting in a full role?
Well, let me see. There was The Vice Guide to Travel, where David Cross and I went to China, and we did some sketches there. There was A Million in the Morning, where we stayed up for 5 days to document the movie watching World Championships, and I lost my mind. Then there was The Brotherhood of the Traveling Rants, which is a stand-up comedy tour, sort of like The Trip. And then, so that was the fourth, I guess, the fourth movie, How to Be a Man. But yeah, acting is easy as shit.
Well, you know what you're doing beforehand. I imagine that's nothing compared to like stand-up comedy.
That's easy, too. You just, if you're funny, it's easy. I never even have a set.
No, that's how I, that's exactly how I always looked at it. You're either funny or you're not.
Yeah. And the funny,
like, you can't fake it.
Out there and stands and smiles and tells a stupid story. I don't even believe – I think it's bad to have a set. I've noticed that when I do a shitty set, and I'm not a comedian. I mean, I've only done it 50 times, 20 times. I don't know how many times. When something happens spontaneous and it's clear it was spontaneous, they laugh way more, even if it's less funny, than what's clearly a well-crafted, heavily practiced joke. Because if you're doing that, it's just karaoke. I mean, I love Jimmy Kimmel and Jimmy Fallon, and even Seth Meyers is good. But when you have 12 people writing for you, I don't know. It just lacks spontaneity. I heard Craig Ferguson, is he the Scottish guy? I heard he just wings it. Yeah. And
well, that's how it should be.
Yeah, people like
you could tell that you could tell the sincerity in a joke when it's just done like that, as opposed to pre-scripted
over and over again,
read to yourself in front of a mirror.
You know what's gross? When comedians do that thing where they pretend it's spontaneous, like they'll say, "I like taking shits." Hey, wait a minute, does that mean I'm gay? I mean, it's just it's going in the opposite direction, and you go, "You didn't just think of that, right?" Well, stop with the "Hey, wait a minute." You've been every night.
Like, I'm not a big. I'm not a big stand-up guy, you know, for the most part. I pick and choose my stand-up comedians, but my favorite all-time album for stand-up was The Day the Laughter Died, Andrew Dice Clay, which is exactly that. Go on stage and just mouth.
Yeah, fuck that guy.
You don't like that?
I don't like masks. I don't like aliases. Like, my whole childhood was Jewish guys acting like stupid Italians.
Which is what he does.
Bowser from Sha Na Na. Henry Winkler doing the Fonz, him, fucking even Harvey Keitel in Mean Streets. It's all this, yeah. And then every Sesame Street character and every cool raisin on a skateboard on my cereal boxes. Hey, I'm a fucking dumb Italian. Yeah. I don't know. Just
Joe's an Italian.
Who's Joe? You?
Joe, the other guy. No. That's me. I'm not. I'm a good boy.
That's the big thing. Listen, you guys are Leviathan fucking Pride and...
No, he's been Leviathan Pride.
What are your real names?
Yeah. Oh, Jeremy.
Joe and Jeremy.
Joe and Jeremy who? Yeah, what's this Joe's full name?
He's Italian. It's scummy.
And what's Jeremy's full name? Jeremy and Joe what? Okay, see, was that so hard?
No, not a bit. But we don't have the fame to stand on like you. You got to get an audience somehow.
Yeah. Where are you guys located?
New Brunswick.
Right on.
Yeah. I was you came from like the Montreal punk scene, right?
Yeah, and Ottawa.
Did I get that right?
Yep, Ottawa and Montreal. I moved from Ottawa when I was 18, so I'd already been in it for about 4 years.
I didn't know the Ottawa one as well, I know, but I came from the punk scene here. And I remember the first time, I don't know if you know the Ripcords out of Montreal.
Oh, yeah.
I assume you might. Yeah, well, the first time the Ripcords came here, it was like, you know, watching punk gods unload on a stage in front of you.
Remember that magazine they had, Rear Guard?
Yeah, when they brought it to the show and I grabbed the copy they had at the show, but it wasn't something that came through here.
That was the best. You know, people living in New York, people go, that's the dude from Gorilla Biscuits, and I know John Joseph from the Cro-Mags, and he's like hardcore royalty in New York, but when we were in Ottawa, all we cared about was Dead Trout, Honest Injun, Grave Concern, The Trapped, our little tiny bands. And you'd read Maximum Rock and Roll, and there'd be these scene reports, and you'd read about their little local scenes. And that's what was so cool about more hardcore than punk, that your town mattered. And it's not like we wished we were at CBGB's and we met Sid Vicious or we'd been at the 100 Club when the Sex Pistols played. We didn't care about that. All we cared about was our bands. I've paid so little attention to Eastern Canada that I forget which one. I mean, the Newfies is Newfoundland.
Newfoundland, yeah.
Halifax had a huge black population, right? They had a big rap scene.
Yes, they did.
It still does.
You had Africaville, didn't you?
Yes, yeah. There's still parts of that you really shouldn't go walking, I guess they say. So let me get one more thing out of you here. Well, and I know you said earlier it was something you kind of personal and touchy, but I'm just dying to know how you got over to the Catholic thing.
It was just the nearest religion, really. My kids were born, and I just felt like an ingrate for not respecting sort of a more cosmic force. And I still obviously believe in the Big Bang and evolution and everything, and I don't think gays are going to hell, and I believe in dinosaurs, but I think that, and I don't think I'm going to have wings and play a harp. I think that all of this stuff is too difficult for our minds to understand. And I think it maybe because I did so much acid in high school that I can sort of wrap my mind around it. But you hear, before you go to church or you listen to that stuff, you hear it's just about fire and brimstone and gays being burned at the stake. Then you get there and it's just platitudes and turn to the person next to you and say, peace be with you. Or I'd go to Latin Mass. And that, you obviously don't understand a word they're saying, but you're just in this beautiful cathedral and you're just so thankful that for the honor of being here. And that's, to me, what religion is about. It's just about giving thanks. And my wife's Indian, and all their things are just give thanks to the north, give thanks to the east, give thanks to the west, give thanks to the south, thanks. They probably came up with Thanksgiving. and that's what it is to me. It's just sort of reverence. But I resent this thing about Christianity where everyone wants to dissect it, and you have Ricky Gervais and his whole, oh, do you think you'll be with your pets? It's more ethereal than that, shithead. You're injecting sort of video games rules on something that our brains are just at the very cusp of getting an edge of.
Yeah, I'm a Catholic myself, so I actually and unconventionally like you, very much unconventionally.
Yeah.
You know, like I have a gay brother, you know, and no one in the family thinks he's going to hell.
Yeah, that's the thing about Catholicism too. Like everyone, they've been pro science for a hell of a long time, and they just want to help people. And even with the most extreme ones, obviously Fred Phelps is too extreme, but they just say, even like people, the Duck Dynasty dude who says they're sinners, he goes, but I'm not saying they're going to hell. I don't judge people. That's not my call.
That was like you. It was blown way out of proportion. It was the simplest, dumbest little thing that was just taken and run with.
Well, technically, it's true. Being gay is technically a sin. But I say, okay, I'm an alcoholic. I was born an alcoholic. I have no intention of changing. I'm perfectly fine with that. I mean, we all sin every day. You covet your neighbor's wife. And I bet a lot of gays, I know a lot of gays who would kind of like the sin thing and don't want it taken away.
No, and you can go sit with your priest, and you can clear that up. I love that about Catholicism.
Not like you're totally absolved. You just have a chance to sort of give penance.
Well, yeah, this is it. You know what?
It's not a race.
And I say a lot of awful things all the time online, but it's you know, I'm a good person for the most part. You know, my priests always like me.
Here's the first question I had for a priest. My grandmother is 97 and they want to put a DNR on her door, do not resuscitate. And she's sort of starving herself to death. She's got a catheter and a colostomy bag. And her thing is, if I drink just a wee bit of water and just one bite, I won't have to change the bags because they'll never get full. And it's like being cheap right to her last days. But I initially said, no, I don't want anyone to die. If she goes, you have to call the ambulance, just like if she was 10. And I looked into it more, and they go, this is an abortion or euthanasia. This is someone who's 97, and if they go, right, and they're gone for a second, and you come in with these incredible machines, we almost are too good at medicine these days, and you bring her back with a defibrillator, and she's been down for a minute, she's going to be brain dead, and now you're keeping this vegetable alive who basically God had already chosen the time, and then you get in there like a grave digger and get her back and then just keep her there on a tube. Now you're the one meddling, you're the one playing God. So
and for what? It's all for selfish reasons. It's all so that, you know, they could keep seeing her.
Right, I don't want my Grammy to die. Yeah, you're right. I think it's selfish. I mean, it's contingent on age. I wouldn't say this about a 60-year-old, but if someone's 97 and they're, you know, she's a withered shadow of her former self. So I think in that case, and all the Catholics I spoke to agreed with me. They said, yeah, this is a different case. DNR it up, boys.
Your folks are Scottish, is that right?
That's correct.
Yeah, and that's heavily, Presbyterian? Protestant.
It's heavily atheist is what it is. I mean, Britain is very atheist these days, but Scotland especially. Scotland just is – Scotland. You know the way Canada is anti-American? Like if Americans – they think Americans are racist based on some redneck stereotype. So they go, okay, then we're multicultural. a lot of their culture, Canada's culture, is to spite America. And I remember in high school when we'd write essays about what makes us Canadian, the whole essay was, well, we don't wear the stars and stripes, and we don't like apple pie, and we don't listen to country music. So Canada, how about what you like? Forget. I always describe him as Elvis's brother. You go, so what are you about, dude? Well, I'll tell you what. I don't have blue suede shoes, and I'm not Mr. Elvis, and I don't like karate. Yeah, yeah, okay, relax. Wait, what was I?
So there was no aversion from your folks to choose the Catholic.
So I think what happens is they see English, like, for example, the English love Christmas. So in Scotland, Christmas is nothing, but it's all about New Year's Eve, Hogmanay. And I think that's just despite the English. So anyway, I think they see the English as sweet little charming goody-two-shoes Christians. So they swing the pendulum the other way and go, oh, that God shit is total shite. I'm not going to believe it for a minute. See that man? Clouds there, that's bullshit. So my parents, their parents, I mean, I probably don't have a Scottish relative who believes in God.
Well,
plus, there's
the whole
Catholic-Protestant thing, where that consumes their whole culture, and that the two soccer teams are Catholic versus Protestant. So I think a lot of them just go, fuck it, I'm sick of fighting.
Well, listen, I'll tell you a story. You like this. When I had my kid baptized, I had it done in New Jersey. I was living down in New Jersey at the time. And the priest, the Catholic priest, in his sermon said, we have to remember to pray for our enemies, and that includes Protestants. That's of my son's baptism.
That's cool.
yeah, totally.
All right, so I figure on that note, again, thanks a lot for being here, Gavin. Really,
what are you cutting him off? Are you?
The time. Well, I'm not cutting him off.
I wasn't the last one to talk.
Yeah, you're right. Exactly. Are you in a rush? Are you?
No. Well, how long are these things?
Yeah. Well, they're as long as until you say fuck off.
Okay, fuck off.